Robert Ryan's role in Day of the Outlaw pushed him beyond his limits, both physically and emotionally. Filmed in the brutal cold of Oregon's wilderness, Ryan played Blaise Starrett, a tough rancher in one of the most intense performances of his career. But the harsh conditions on set and personal challenges took a heavy toll on the actor. What seemed like another gritty Western turned into a life-changing experience that would leave a lasting impact. How did this film cost him everything? Robert Ryan's life was an adventure long before he ever set foot in front of a camera. Born in Chicago in 1909, Ryan grew up in a traditional Catholic family. He wasn't the kind of kid to just sit around. He was always on the move. He had energy and a kind of determination that would later define his career. In his early days, he went through life like someone searching for purpose, not sure where he belonged, but willing to try anything to find out. And try he did, boxing, ranch work, even stoking the fires on a ship that took him to faraway places like Africa. It was a life filled with grit, sweat, and hard labor. His education came from Dartmouth College, an Ivy League school. You might picture the place as full of books and serious scholars, but for Ryan, his focus wasn't just on academics. He was a force in the ring, holding the heavyweight boxing title for all 4 years of his time there. Boxing wasn't just a sport for him. It was a way to channel his restless energy and test himself in ways that studying couldn't. But life after college wasn't easy or clear-cut. He took on various jobs that were as physically demanding as his time in the ring. He worked for the Works Progress Administration, WPA, a government program designed to put Americans back to work during the Great Depression. It was a time of economic struggle, and Ryan, like many, took what he could get. He even found himself on a ranch in Montana, getting his hands dirty and living the rugged lifestyle that might have seemed far removed from Hollywood's glamour. In 1937, everything changed when he decided to give acting a shot. It was a bold move, but Ryan wasn't one to back down from a challenge. By 1939, he had signed with Paramount Pictures. You'd think that signing with a big studio like Paramount would mean instant fame, but for Ryan, it was the opposite. His first role was in a boxing movie, not much of a stretch considering his background, but it wasn't enough to impress anyone. Paramount gave him two more small parts in Westerns, Northwest Mounted Police and Texas Rangers Ride Again. In both films, you'd have to squint to catch a glimpse of him, and that was if you didn't blink. One role had him playing a Mountie, and the other, an uncredited citizen with a pencil-thin mustache. It was a start, but barely. Despite these small roles, Ryan wasn't about to give up. Hollywood was a tough business, and he knew that success wouldn't come overnight. He took his talents to Broadway, hoping that the stage might give him the break he was searching for. And in a way, it did. While his time in New York didn't make him a household name, it caught the attention of people who could help push his career forward. By 1943, Ryan had moved to RKO Pictures, a studio known for its gritty films and noirs. His time there was marked by a steady rise in stature, starting with a role in The Sky's the Limit, where he played a friend to Fred Astaire. This was a different kind of role, one that allowed him to show a bit more of his range. But it wasn't until he starred opposite Ginger Rogers in Tender Comrade that people really started to take notice. Directed by Edward Dimitrik, the film was a hit, and Ryan's star power was officially on the rise. However, just as things were heating up in Hollywood, World War II intervened. Like many young men of his time, Ryan enlisted in the military. From 1944 to 1945, he served in the U.S. Marines. His time in the service wasn't just about duty. It also allowed him to form lifelong friendships, including with Richard Brooks, a writer and director who would become a key figure in Ryan's life and career. It was also during this period that Ryan took up painting, a quiet hobby that might have been surprising for someone so rugged on the outside. After the war, Ryan returned to acting, and this time he found himself in more substantial roles. In 1947, he got his first real taste of the Western genre with Trail Street, playing opposite Randolph Scott. It wasn't a flashy role, though. His character, Alan Harper, was a good-hearted capitalist helping Kansas farmers fight against greedy ranchers. It was a typical story of the time, with Ryan playing the nobleman in a sea of trouble. But something was missing. Ryan was too intense, too complex to play a straight-up good guy. That same year, Ryan had his big breakthrough, but not in a Western. It came in Crossfire, another collaboration with director Edward Dmytryk. The film was a noir thriller, and Ryan played an anti-Semitic killer, a role so chilling and impactful that it earned him an Academy Award nomination for Best Supporting Actor. Crossfire was a success, and it opened new doors for Ryan, but not necessarily the ones he was expecting. Instead of leading men roles in mainstream films, he found himself more often cast as a villain, a role he played with surprising depth and skill, but the Westerns kept coming. In 1948, he reunited with Randolph Scott for Return of the Bad Men. This time, though, Ryan was playing the Sundance Kid, a far cry from his previous do-gooder role. The movie assembled a lineup of outlaws, from the Dalton brothers to Billy the Kid, but it was Ryan's portrayal of Sundance that stole the show. He was ruthless, cold, and calculating. In just half an hour of screen time, he managed to murder an unarmed Indian, strangle a blonde heroine, and shoot a partner in the back. It was dark, unsettling, and utterly captivating. For the first time, Ryan's full potential as a Western villain was on display. From then on, Ryan became known for his roles as men who straddled the line between good and evil, or simply chose the wrong side altogether. His next Western, Best of the Bad Men in 1951, was a bit of a step back as he returned to playing a tough but decent guy. The film had a stacked cast with Robert Preston, Walter Brennan, and Bruce Cabot, among others, but it wasn't a standout in Ryan's career. The plot was tangled, and Ryan's good guy persona didn't have the same bite as his darker roles. Things picked up again when he starred in Horizons West the following year. Directed by Bud Boetticher, the film cast Ryan as Dan Hammond, a villain who dreams of building an empire at any cost. Ryan dominated the screen with an intensity that overshadowed even big names like Rock Hudson and James Arness. He was back where he belonged, playing a character with dangerous ambition, someone willing to betray friends and family to get what he wanted. Around this time, Ryan made the move to MGM, and with that came two of his most iconic Western roles. One was in The Naked Spur in 1953, where he played Ben Vandergroat, a manipulative outlaw being hunted down by James Stewart's character. The film was a high-stakes cat-and-mouse game, set against the backdrop of rugged mountains. It was tense, gripping, and Ryan's portrayal of Vandergroat was chilling. You could feel the menace in every word he spoke. Some might argue that The Naked Spur was his best Western, and they wouldn't be wrong. After The Naked Spur, you'd think Robert Ryan had reached the peak of his Western career. But then came Day of the Outlaw in 1959, and it became clear that Ryan had one more unforgettable role up his sleeve, one that would leave an indelible mark on his career and his life. Directed by Andre de Toth, Day of the Outlaw was a Western unlike any other. Set in the snowy wilderness of Wyoming, it told the story of a small town under siege by an outlaw gang, led by Burl Ives' menacing character. The weather was as much a part of the film as the actors, with biting cold and snowstorms creating a sense of isolation and desperation. And at the center of it all was Ryan, playing Blaise Starrett, a hard-as-nails rancher determined to save his town from the outlaws. Starrett was unlike any hero Ryan had played before. Sure, he was technically the good guy, but there was nothing soft about him. He wasn't the clean-cut marshal or the noble cowboy. Starrett was rough, stubborn, and steely. He wasn't trying to save the town out of some high-minded sense of duty. He just wanted to survive, and he'd do whatever it took to get there. Ryan brought an intensity to the role that made it impossible to look away. You could feel the weight of every decision he made. He didn't say much, but you could see the wheels turning in his mind as he figured out how to outsmart the gang and protect his people. It was a masterclass in quiet strength and raw tension. The film itself was beautifully shot, with Russell Harlan's black-and-white cinematography bringing out every harsh line in the snowy landscape. The cold practically seeped through the screen, and you could see it in the actors' faces, especially Ryan's. But what really made Day of the Outlaw stand out was its atmosphere. The tension in the town was palpable. You could feel the fear and the uncertainty as the outlaws took over, and Ryan Starrett became the unlikely leader of a town on the edge of destruction. The story was adapted from a 1955 novel by Lee Edwin Wells, and producer Buddy Adler had originally bought the film rights as a vehicle for Robert Wagner. But when the project finally came together, It was clear that no one but Robert Ryan could have played Starrett. The script, written by Philip Yordan, was tight and focused, but it wasn't without its problems. Yordan himself later admitted that the budget was too small for the kind of movie he wanted to make. At just $400,000, it was a shoestring budget for a Western of this scale. The production faced numerous challenges, from snowstorms that delayed filming to director Andre de Toth's personal struggles that sometimes affected his decision-making on set. And then, there was Ryan's own battle with pneumonia, which forced him to miss a week of filming. These issues could have sunk a lesser movie, but Day of the Outlaw survived them all. Despite the obstacles, Ryan's performance stood out as one of the best of his career. You could see the exhaustion in his eyes, the weariness of a man who had been pushed to the brink but refused to break. It wasn't just acting. It was Ryan pouring himself into the character in a way that left an impact long after the credits rolled. But the intense experience of making Day of the Outlaw came at a cost for Ryan. The grueling shoot, combined with the harsh conditions and his illness, took a toll on his health. De Toth's decision to change locations at the last minute, moving from indoor scenes to remote exteriors, only added to the strain. The physical demands of the role, along with the mounting stress on set, left Ryan drained. It was clear that this film, for all its brilliance, had pushed him to the edge. Yordan, the scriptwriter, later reflected on what Day of the Outlaw could have been if they'd had more money and time. But even with the limitations, the film is often regarded as one of the most intense and atmospheric westerns ever made. And a large part of that comes down to Ryan's performance. The film's reception was mixed when it was first released, with some critics praising its tension and atmosphere, while others were put off by its bleakness. But over time, Day of the Outlaw has earned its place as a cult classic, recognized for its stark beauty and unforgettable performances. As the 1960s rolled in, Robert Ryan's career began to shift. Like many actors at the time, he dipped his toes into television. But Ryan wasn't interested in locking himself into a long-running series. He wasn't the type to get comfortable in one role for years on end. He knew that taking a lead in a TV series could pigeonhole him, and Ryan wanted to avoid that at all costs. He once said, "Sure, I might make a million or so in a series, but I'd wind up being Sidewinder Sam for the rest of my life." Still, he did make some notable appearances on TV. He made his small screen debut as none other than Abraham Lincoln in Screen Directors Playhouse. He also popped up in Western anthologies doing episodes of Zane Grey Theater and Wagon Train. In each of these, Ryan showed exactly why he avoided becoming a series regular. He commanded every scene he was in, overshadowing the rest of the cast without even trying. That same larger-than-life quality is probably why his next Western, The Canadians in 1961, fell flat. Directed by Burt Kennedy, the movie was one of those Mountie-centered Westerns that just couldn't capture the same magic as its American counterparts. Ryan starred as a tough Mountie, but the film moved at a glacial pace. The script felt slow and lifeless, and Ryan, for the first time, looked like he wasn't fully invested. You could sense his boredom in the role, as though he knew the material wasn't worth his time. It's no surprise that The Canadians is one of the least memorable Westerns Ryan ever made. But just when it seemed like his Western career might be tapering off, Ryan bounced back with a supporting role in The Professionals in 1966. Directed by his longtime friend Richard Brooks, the film was about a group of mercenaries hired to rescue a kidnapped woman in Mexico. Ryan played a horse expert in the team, alongside Lee Marvin, Burt Lancaster, and Woody Strode. While Ryan's part wasn't the biggest, his understated performance fit perfectly within the ensemble. The film was a hit, and though Ryan was overshadowed by the more bombastic performances of Marvin and Lancaster, he brought a quiet strength to his role that made the whole team feel more grounded. The following year, Ryan took on another supporting role, this time in Hour of the Gun in 1967, directed by John Sturges. The film claimed to tell the true story of Wyatt Earp and Doc Holliday after the OK Corral, but as with many Hollywood Westerns, the historical accuracy was questionable at best. Ryan played Ike Clanton, the tough rancher who goes head-to-head with James Garner's Earp. While the story wasn't exactly grounded in fact, Ryan's portrayal of Clanton was solid. He brought his usual intensity, giving depth to a character who could have easily been a one-note villain. Still, it was far from his best Western, and the film itself wasn't a standout in the genre. Not long after, Ryan made a brief appearance in Custer of the West, a film that didn't do much to improve his late career Western resume. Directed by Robert Siodmak and starring Robert Shaw as the infamous General Custer, the movie was long and frankly tedious. Ryan played a deserter named Mulligan, but the role was largely extraneous to the plot. It felt like Ryan was just going through the motions, delivering his lines with little of the fire he usually brought to the screen. The script didn't help either. Meandering dialogue and an overlong runtime made the movie a chore to sit through. By this point, it was clear that not every Western was going to be a winner, but no actor, not even the great Robert Ryan, could escape making a turkey or two. The late 1960s were a time when many Western stars were heading to Spain for the growing Italian Western genre. Ryan wasn't immune to the pull either. In 1968, he appeared in A Minute to Pray, A Second to Die, a spaghetti Western that didn't quite hit the mark. Ryan played New Mexico Governor Lem Carter, but the film itself was forgettable, a far cry from his earlier triumphs in the genre. However, just when it seemed like Ryan's Western days might be behind him, he landed one of his most iconic roles in Sam Peckinpah's The Wild Bunch, 1969. By now, Ryan was pushing 60, and his age brought a new kind of depth to his performance. The Wild Bunch was about a group of aging outlaws trying to survive in a world that was leaving them behind. Ryan played Deke Thornton, a former outlaw turned bounty hunter, tasked with hunting down his old friends. The role was perfect for him, gritty, complex, and layered with regret. The whole film was about men past their prime, struggling to find their place in a world that no longer had room for them. Ryan's performance as Thornton was brilliant, standing shoulder to shoulder with screen legends like William Holden and Ernest Borgnine. Of course, no film set was without its drama, and The Wild Bunch was no exception. Rumors circulated that Ryan clashed with director Sam Peckinpah over billing, but what's more likely is that Ryan, like the rest of the cast, was frustrated with Peckinpah's notorious behavior on set. Stories of Peckinpah's verbal abuse towards the crew and cast became legendary. At one point, Ryan threatened to punch the director, and his co-stars, Holden and Borgnine, weren't far behind in their complaints. Despite the behind-the-scenes tension, The Wild Bunch turned out to be a masterpiece, and Ryan's performance as Thornton added an extra layer of gravitas to the film's already heavy themes. As his Western career wound down, Ryan took on one last role in Lawman, 1971, directed by Michael Winner. The film, though packed with stars like Burt Lancaster and Lee J. Cobb, was ultimately a disappointment. The script was weak, and the movie had a cheap 1970s feel that didn't quite capture the spirit of the classic Westerns Ryan was known for. He played a washed-up local marshal, and while his performance was solid, it was clear the film wasn't on par with his best work. Still, Ryan managed to rise above the material, proving once again that even in a subpar film, he could deliver. By the time Lawman was released, Ryan had already discovered he had inoperable cancer of the lymph glands. Despite the diagnosis, he kept working, showing the same resilience that had defined his life and career. In one of his final interviews, he reflected on his life, saying, "I've had a good shot at life." He passed away in July 1973, leaving behind a legacy of unforgettable performances, especially in the Western genre that had shaped so much of his career. Robert Ryan was a force to be reckoned with, a man who could play the darkest of villains or the most conflicted of heroes. His career in Westerns, though filled with highs and a few lows, cemented his place as one of the genre's greats. And while Day of the Outlaw may have cost him dearly, it also stands as a testament to the kind of actor he was, relentless, committed, and unforgettable.